Hello, I'm Florent Verbroek, Technical Marketing Manager at AMD, and in this quick tech video, I will introduce the AMD Versal AI Engine Rapid Prototyping using the AMD Vitis Unified IDE. Before looking at how we can do rapid prototyping in the AMD Vitis Unified IDE, let's first look at what rapid prototyping is. During system partitioning, planning, and validation, the main objective is to reduce risk and identify any gaps in assumptions that may have been made earlier. After brainstorming, a draft proposal can be prepared to address any problems. The rapid prototyping of AI engine subsystems phase involves resource estimation, including identifying the tile counts, buffer usage, PLIO resources, and stream array traffic, as well as assessing the latency and throughput feasibility with early data flow simulation, prototype kernel coding, and initiation interval loop analysis. For algorithm mapped to the AI engine, you can review the Vitis libraries to see if any existing library block element matches your needs. If so, run quick simulations to determine the throughput and latency performances of those library blocks. Otherwise, it is useful to develop and investigate candidate vectorization options and consider how to use the SIMD processor to improve throughput. This might involve coding kernels in isolation to identify the number of cycles required to loop through the data. We can use an example to explain the rapid prototyping further. Here, we are looking at a digital up conversion or DUC chain. The digital up conversion chain is a key component in wireless communication systems to translate a signal from baseband to intermediate frequency band. In our example, the DUC chain contains an FIR fractional resampler, a series of L-band interpolators, DDS mixer functions, and an adder functional block. The FIR fractional resampler, the half-band interpolators, and the DDS mixer functions can be implemented using the Vitis DSP library, which is available on GitHub. The adder function is not available in the Vitis DSP library. This will need to be custom coded. We will assume you have already implemented the first part of the chain using the DSP library, and we will focus on the fast prototyping of the custom kernel, which is the custom adder. During the requirements gathering stage of design analysis, the input and output data types, coefficient types, number of taps, sampling rate, and the kernel function need to be identified. Here, we are using a simple example of a custom kernel with an adder function, but you could apply the same steps for more complex kernels. AI engine system mapping is the next phase of design analysis. It is important to identify the system requirements and understand how they can drive the implementation cost. When mapping an AI engine system, you'll need to identify the resources available in the hardware, such as the number of AI engine tiles, storage, buffers, and connectivity ports. These parameters are interdependent in terms of understanding the proper data flow in a design. The compute parameter identifies the number of AI tiles or processors required for running the algorithm design, and storage describes memory requirements such as buffer size, local memory of the AI engines, non-neighbor tile memory, or DMA size. Input-output bandwidth is used to identify I/O requirements such as the number of PLIO ports, clocking, and buffer or stream interfaces. Analyzing the design based on these mapping parameters before implementation helps to achieve your design goal. Mapping the design requirements for our custom adder kernel requires understanding the design needs. Here, we need to produce a sampling rate of 1200 megasamples per second with a latency less than 500 nanoseconds. The adder will be implemented in one tiles, and it has two inputs and one output of complex integer 16 data type. As the design is a simple adder that takes 1 MAC per clock cycle, one single AI engine tile can perform this function. The input for this kernel is fed through two input buffers. We are deciding that each of these buffers will store 384 samples. Knowing that each sample is stored on 4 bytes, it means that this adder kernel takes 3 kilobytes of data at a sampling rate of 1200 megasamples per second. AI engine rapid prototyping is the next phase of design analysis. The rapid prototyping of an AI engine subsystem is not mandatory. However, it does help with early analysis of the design before actual implementation. It involves 3 steps. Building empty kernel wrappers, building the graph and compiling, simulating and analyzing for an early estimation. To help users prototyping their AI engine application, AMD has introduced a new feature called the AI engine rapid prototyping, which is available in the Vitis Unified ID in 2020.4.2 and which helps quickly generate data flow models. The generated model is built with a kernel for which the ports can be parameterized. The model includes the final multicore graph topology with full buffering and stream details and all LUT storages. This model can then be run through AI engine compilation to explore the hardware utilization, as well through the AI engine emulation to ensure it can meet the throughput and latency requirements. To use the rapid prototyping feature in the Vitis Unified IDE, create a new empty AI engine component. On the AI engine component settings page, you'll see an option Generate AI prototype code. Clicking on this option will open a new wizard. In this wizard, you can enter parameters for the kernel, such as the name of the kernel, the number of input ports and their name, type, data type, and dimension, the number of output ports and their name, type, data type, and dimension, and any lookup table if you need any in your kernel. Let's have a full example in the tool using the custom adder for the duck chain. We have Vitis Unified IDE 2020.4.2 opened. We'll start by creating a new AI engine component by clicking on File, New Component, AI engine. We can give a name to this new component, for example, Duck Adder. To use the rapid prototyping feature, we must have an empty component, so we are not adding any source file at this time. Here, we have selecting the VCK190 base platform as target, but the feature is available for any device or platform with one of the variants of AI engine. The new AI engine component is now created, and we are directly on the component setting page. We can click on the Generate AI engine prototype code option to open the rapid prototyping feature. In this window, we can set the kernel properties. For example, we can set its name to Duck Adder. Then, we can set the properties of the input ports, so we know that our sample are 16-bit complex, and we are setting the size of the buffer to receive 384 samples. We have two inputs, so we need to add a new port, and set as well the data type to CIN16 and the dimension to 384 samples. And we set the same properties on the output buffer, data type to CIN16, and dimension to 384 samples. Finally, we can enable the generate top-level graph and simulation code so the tool will generate a graph application code to run the graph through simulation. We can see in the engine component that the tool has created four files. The first one is graph.cpp, which is the graph application to run the graph through simulation. This is a very common file that you have probably seen in other tutorials. Here the tool is setting the graph to run for one iteration, but we will change this setting to 4 so we'll get a better analysis of the throughput. The second file is graph.h, which is the definition of the graph. We can see that the tool has generated the full graph with the definition of the input and output PLIOs, the creation of the kernel object, and its connectivity. For the PLIOs, by default the tool is setting the PLIO width to 32-bit, but I will change it to 64-bit as this is the native width on the hardware. You can also see that in the PLIO definition, the code refers to input text files. These files are not generated by the tools and we will have to add our input files for the simulation. The two other files are the kernel header and source file. We can look into the source file duckadder.cpp. We can see that the code generated by the tool is an empty wrapper. We will have to complete the kernel implementation. First, we can add the definition of the input and output iterators to access the input and output buffers. Then, we can add a loop to access all the samples. Then, we could do a simple path through from one input to the output, like this one. But as our code is simple, we can directly do the add operation between the two inputs and send the result to the output. As we mentioned earlier, we need to add text files for the simulation. Here, I will add a folder with the two text files which are already created. They contain a list of values with 4 values per line, representing the two complex 16 samples per clock on a 64-bit interface. We can now build the engine component. This can take a few minutes. When the component is built, we can run the simulation. First, we need to configure the simulation. We will enable the traces in the simulation, so the simulator will give us information about the throughput. Then, we'll run the simulation. After a few minutes, the simulation completes, and we can see in the log the reported throughput of 5000 megabytes per second, or 1250 mega 16-bit complex samples per second, which matches our requirements. This means that we can integrate our kernel in our full system. This last step is not shown in our video. This is the end of our quick tech video about the quick prototyping feature. Thank you for watching.